going, everyone? The jams are still playing.
It's coming. So there we go. I was like ready to boogie.
We just grooved with it. Just be like, oh, yeah, like, we're back. Well,
we're back in our spaceship of groove, and we're ready for game number two. As Team Unknown, very dominant in game number one, taking down eHug here. eHug looking for their first win today. Maybe a bit off their... You know, their normal thing, but, you know, Nyx Assassin second pick, it's felt a bit off for eHug so far. So we'll have to look for them to kind of shake that one off. But on the other side, you have Unknown, who, at the rate they're playing, they might not be Unknown soon.
Yeah, I feel like they just played a really solid standard game. That's what it felt like to me. They executed their picks correctly. It looked like the way that a lot of other teams are playing recently with their top heroes and their top picks. They did their lanes good. They did their ganks really well. And transitioned really well into a stomp, so well played by them. So eHug again going with the Shadow Fiend. I think the Shadow Fiend was a good pick. Justin played it well. It definitely gave them a bit of kick into successfulness in the mid game, but it didn't overall work out. I think what they really needed was their supports to perform a little better in the last game, and their offlane to perform better. I think there wasn't a whole lot Infinity could have done that game. So I would like... Oh, they picked Lion as well. I was like, Storm Spirit, pick Lion. Hurry, do it! But it's already gone.
There's other good support options if they want to go Benevolent. Shadow Demon, I think, is not too shadow.
Against Storm, no.
But not anymore.
Like, you can save people, but it doesn't, like, kill Storm is the problem. I almost never pick Shadow Demon versus Storm myself. It just, unless he's out of mana, you can't lock him down. It's not a good option.
So now,
Rubick's a good second option.
Yeah. Skywrath Mage also could have been something decent with the Silence.
It's better to pick the stuns. You just want something that's like, I know for sure that I can stop him from doing things if I initiate first. You want to force him to buy BKBs and stuff like that. If you're playing Skywrath, and there's a lot of times as well where Skywrath is turning around to silence you, and he starts casting animation, then you roll again, and you cancel the animation, you have to cast silence again. You can just get outplayed. Rubick is a good option. Lion is a good option. You need that instant disable to prevent him from being able to do what he wants to do. So, but interesting to see the Storm picked up so early in the draft.
That's confidence, I feel, almost, from Team Unknown to grab it up this early.
And a TA still banned. I guess Justin really doesn't like playing versus TA, and he's the drafter as well. So he's the mid player. He's like, I don't want to play versus TA.
Yeah, I was hanging out at lunch, actually, yesterday with, I believe it was Dreskel Shane and Blitz, and there was a bit of a discussion talking about Shadow Fiend and how they don't really care for that matchup against a TA, you know, given if she gets to do as she please, she builds up into level 6, she gets that second trap down, and even a Shadow Fiend will quiver from it. So it could become a bit of a heated battle just between the two of them, and I guess they don't want to risk going into that, you know. Mm-hmm. Usually you could just pull over the one sentry ward, and Shadow Fiend would be more in the clear, but I guess he doesn't want to play more of that reserve Shadow Fiend. He'd like to maybe get off to a strong start and not have to rely on getting that level 4 or 5 and raises to get back into the game. And there it is again, another Huskar ban, more of a respect ban, of course, to, I believe, Mr. Kanoa. So we'll have to see.
I was a little surprised to see Storm picked up so early, though. I don't know if it'll be mid or safe lane. Could be either way. We've been seeing a lot of Storm safes lately. But things can kind of go over the place. Same thing as the previous patch, or the previous game, sorry, or at least maybe one of the games today. A lot of strong trialing heroes getting banned out second phase. Undyne still has a really high win rate, so not too surprising to see him get banned. Disruptor is pretty good against Storm as well, so one of the options. It's maybe not the best late game, but in the early mid, you can really punish the Storm Spirit if the Disruptor has good levels. So I think that would have been a good combo. Rubick, Disruptor, good team fight, pretty good gank. If you're under farmed, it's still okay. And a Witch Doctor pick, an occasional support pick.
Yeah, gotta acknowledge, of course, that you know this means they passed up on some of the other top priority supports. Your Chen, your Wisp, just going to be completely bypassed this game.
Yep.
So, well, at least so far, unless eHug want to pick up one of them for their secondary here, in addition to the Rubick, we'll have to see. But yeah, Witch Doctor, you make the call. Having just the good old reliable stun certainly helps. Unknown already got a couple of them here to work with. But they need to round out this lineup with something that can help them out a bit in the late game. Nice, strong, sturdy offlaner, perhaps, whether it be like their own Bristle or Clockwork or... We'll have to see, but... Well, they're going to go with the Skywrath Mage.
Okay. I don't know if I like the Sky too much here. Obviously, the Silence is good against Storm, but I feel like there's a lot of disable and lockdown for Unknown right now. I mean, their first three picks, and they've already got Cask Bounces, they've got Storm Spirit and Storm Spirit Pull, and they've got Lion Stun. I was thinking Shadow Demon, excuse me, when I saw the Witch Doctor, because so much disable at this point that they almost need to keep somebody alive, and Sky's not going to be able to do that. And Shadow Demon SF is actually really good, because it guarantees that he can put his BKB down. If he does get chain stunned, you're like, okay, I'm going to let you BKB, you can BKB, and the Shadow Fiend can do Shadow Fiend things. But against this many stuns, and if they get, like, Maledict, hexed into like Finger of Death, like he's gonna die. And SD is decent against Spearbreaker as well, but basically what Skywrath Mage provides is really good lane control. You can zone the offlaner pretty well, and then in the mid to late game you can transition into ganks, I guess, with your ultimate. But in big team fights with really farmed heroes, Sky is kind of crappy, I feel, is the problem.
Maybe so. They have plans for him. They could pair him with like a Faceless Void or something to really get the most out of Skywrath Mage.
We haven't seen that forever. I'm not a huge fan of Sky right now. There are a few top teams that pick him. Alliance drafted him a lot at Starladder, but almost no other team would pick Sky regularly. And I feel justified saying that he's probably better this patch than the previous one because late game is less good, and Sky is definitely an early game hero, an early mid game hero.
Support's got the overall buff. If they do participate in those early ganks, yeah, they get a nice little extra lump sum.
Yeah, that's true. But, I mean, they didn't know the Spearbreaker was coming, but there's another weakness to Sky. He can't stop Spearbreaker in any way. He can silence him, but it does nothing. Yeah. The charge will still go through. Mm-hmm. His slow is not going to affect him. It's always going to just prevent the ultimate from coming through, and that's another weakness of Skywrath Mage. I mean, I learned so much by playing like solo queue pubs. It's like I'm learning drafting by playing solo queue because I learned like what heroes just what
bad,
support heroes just
good,
suck
yeah.
on average, like or like what if they pick certain things? Is your support going to be worthless compared to like having a line or something?
No, I can
just
attest to that.
Skywrath Mage, unless they get a lot of ganks off, I feel Sky is just a weak hero here. You can zone in like his early laning. Yeah, sure, you can zone offlaners really well, but you can do that with a lot of other supports.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
And it costs Bane. You less mana. Like yeah,
Shadow
Bane
Demon
is a good example.
Oh,
Shadow
my
Demon's
goodness.
Decent. Like a lot of ranged heroes are good at zoning in a lot of ways. So Sven will be the pick.
This is the second Sven I've seen today, by the way. We saw it in
okay.
our first series.
Did he lose?
They did lose.
Okay.
It was Monkeys
was
Forever,
lane,
and he went with a Mech Arcanes and went into the Greaves.
That's right, the Greaves rush. It's yeah. kind of cool, I guess, with Warcry, because you could potentially give your team 30 armor or something when they're low, but I don't know if I like that. I don't like Sven here very much because he's a melee hero that requires not to be stunned, and Unknown has 4 stuns.
And great mobility with Storm Spirit, and he could be kind
of... Yeah, that's not a hero Sven can deal with at all. And Storm Spirit, if he wants to, he can spend a lot of mana to just permanently slow Sven using Overcharge. So Sven has to get a BKB. This is the most BKB Sven game I've seen in my entire life. And even then, look at the heroes they have. They have 3 ranged heroes. They've got a Spirit Breaker. So the cleave is unlikely to do that much. It feels like a peel or something. I'd be like, yeah, cool, pick Sven. But I don't think Sven is going to be the pick here. It might work out really well.
Oh,
an Ursa pick. So that's the strat. It's offlane Spirit Breaker, carry Ursa, safe lane Storm Spirit. And they are Radiant, by the way. So taking Roche is a little scary, but should be fairly possible, especially if they get a little bit of a gold advantage.
I'm very curious for this last pick from eHug. It's got to be something to help out this Sven. Like, get him into the fights or, you know, make it a lot easier.
Okay, I like that. Clockwork. Especially with Ursa carry, I think Clock is a great pick.
Oh,
yeah. You can zone him decently using the cogs and things like that. So, a bit of a weird draft. I think Unknowns is a lot safer just because they do have so many stuns, and I think their lanes are a bit better. Their hero scale really well late game. But the Clock pick is fantastic here because can definitely solo kill Witch Doctor or Lion, and it also creates a lot of zoning pressure for the Spirit Breaker and Ursa. If they didn't have a Clockwork, I'd be like eHug lost for sure. But with the Clock, I feel like they're in an okay spot. Really depends on how well the supports do on eHug. That's really the important part here because Shadow Fiend's going to do fine, but they do have to deal with Lion and Witch Doctor ganks.
Yeah.
It's all about the rotations. Which team is going to rotate better, I think, is what's happening. That's who's going
to
win.
The theme seems to be that Team Unknown are just very manly. I mean, they like to play their Huskar. They're going to go right for the Ursa here. They had the early call for the Storm Spirit. I mean, maybe they're feeling a bit of a stride, a lot of confidence right here, but... You know, it's a bit of a scary lineup to be looking at here. eHug, you know, they did last game that early pick of the Nyx Assassin. Couldn't help but have a bit of a question mark on that one. This one with the Sven now, we'll have to see how it goes for them, but I feel like it's just a lot more pressure on them. You know, still looking to get that win. Might be enough to help boost that morale a bit, but for now, it's just more of a struggle. So, like we saw last game, it looks like now Unknown are going to be putting a lot of priority on this top rune, committing all 5 for it here, maybe hoping for a fresh and easy first blood. Which they certainly do have a respectable amount of lockdown to lead in. Maybe they already have the charge leveled up, followed up with an Earth Spike. Of course, the cast could be there. This could be pretty solid for Unknown.
We got a Witch Doctor taunting.
Oh, look at that mask, too.
I've actually never seen this set before. Is this new?
So confident. Yeah, I don't know.
Gift received.
You know, he cannot see anything, I don't imagine, through that thing. Yeah, he is just...
Must be new. I've never seen this one before.
He's dancing it up right there on the high ground, though.
So they can spot the Shadow Fiend, and they've only... Oh, they've actually got a pretty good level 1, though. I mean, Sven's a pretty good level 1 hero. It's going to cost him a Mango to stun, though. They're going to spot the Storm Spirit. Oh, he goes high ground. Here comes the charge. Oh. It's only going to stun Shadow Fiend, though. He gets lifted first, and a little bit of nuke on him. Great stun, Earth Spike by Lion. Justin's in trouble. Great bounce. Bounce twice on the Shadow Fiend. He's getting low. That should be his death.
Oh.
Shadow Fiend goes down, and they did not get the Bounty Rune. Double Bounty Rune to the Raiding Team, and they got First Blood. And Shadow Fiend doesn't have money for a TP scroll. Never mind, TP scroll down. Thank God they had money for that. If they didn't have money, he would have been so screwed. And that costs MJW 100 gold to start his offlane. So that's a pretty big loss there for Shadow Fiend. And he also skilled Raze, so maybe he's going to do that on purpose. Yeah, he is going to get some CS out of this. At least it's a strategy that some SFs do, so maybe he did do this on purpose. But that was ideal for Unknown. They started off with a Spirit Breaker doing a bad charge. Mm-hmm. It was a bad charge on purpose, because then what did eHug do? They used all of their stuns on the Spirit Breaker with 5 armor and Stout Shield. That's great for them. So charge comes on the Skywrath Mage now, and he's being right-clicked.
Z-Talk holding onto the cast, going to throw it out as it gets closer to the wave. Now will it bounce? It certainly
will
bounce.
And back! What the hell is with the RNG here now? Do they have enough to bring him down? They don't.
Almost.
But man, he gets hurt. He's going to have to start ripping into those tangos to get just back into fighting shape. But Team Unknown, man, leading into the game, double runes. Their mid laner gets the first blood. They take down the opposing mid laner. You couldn't really ask for a better start, and they have been reading eHug very well at this point. Uh-oh, back at top lane. Now they're going to make their go onto Greedy. They get the pullback with Telekinesis. He's looking to turn the corner. He's just going to fight his way out from this one, but he will end up going down. eHug get themselves on the board and do manage to even things up with the help of Jaw rotating in on his Rubick.
Did cost him a Mango on Sven, but they scored the kill, and they've got a lot of Clarities as well, so they should be able to be just fine. Getting his mana pool back up. Still level 1 on Spirit Picker. That's actually pretty rough on him. He needs 2 to have the charging bash as he passes through people. So until he hits 2, things get a little harder here. And there's the Clarity. That'll be Sven's mana for the next stun. And they're going to start to do some stacking. Definitely something they have to do. Stacking is really important this game. Not only do they have Shadow Fiend, but they also have a Sven. Both heroes very, very strong at stacking. But I wish Bloody Nine was going for the double stack here. It's a little dangerous, but and sometimes you can mess it up. But you can definitely stack both the medium camp as well as the large. Well, you have to do it through this like little gap, and then they go this way and shit. But
at least he's got the one stacked a little bit, at least for now. So a little something to fall back on for Justin to work with to raise his way back into the game. The nice thing is Clockwork kind of had some early XP boost here. It looks like he's been forced to step back, probably went to scout out the bottom rune, but now he's made his return. Mr. Kotaro, though, on his Ursa is near the top of his own CS, 13-3. We already mentioned a little bit about being on Radiant's side, it's a bit more tricky to go right away for the Roche, but do you anticipate something they're still going to go for? He actually already has 1,200 gold on Ursa. He must have saved and not purchased a whole lot at the start of the game.
Yeah, it looks like he maybe just got a Stout and a Salve, and that's something you can get away with if it's just a solo clock. Because Clock doesn't want to trade hits with you because Ursa gets bonus Fury Swipes damage for 15 seconds, so I think he just went greedy on his early build and actually hasn't even been mana drained much here. Just MJW not getting any mana drain or anything going. So pretty good lane for Ursa, basically. And it was fine for the supports to rotate and move around because they did have that advantageous 1v1 matchup.
Do you think he's going to go right for the Vlads then early, or maybe a Blink Dagger if he wants to get more engaged?
This is a Blink game, I think, because they've got a Rubick lift. But other than that, it's just so the fight going on top, lift onto the Spirit Breaker. He already did charge, though. So I feel like a Blink was going to be the way to go. I mean, he can kill Rubick and Skywrath Mage. Skywrath is a really easy kill. Might even see a dead Clockwork here. He's gone. Oh, doesn't get the overpower off in time. And now the chase bonus damage from the shot. And no!
Oh! He tried to man up there, but barely. Bloody Nine just in the bloody nick of time to get there and help out.
That was the silence. Yeah, Bloody Nine made that gank happen. If he didn't silence him there, I'm sure the Ursa was like, I'm going to get him kind of low. And then when I think he's going to die to the overpower, then that's when I use overpower.
What good timing, too. Excel was working with a pull, I believe, at the same time or something. Just was not close enough to be helping out. And Ursa was at his lonesome. He makes his return, but he does lose a little bit of that huge lump sum of money he's had. So with that, he'll just have to go back into the grind here, and they got to be on the watch out here for Bloody Nine, who's still floating around here. And Justin does manage to pick up a regen rune, but looks like he's going to take it back to his mid lane here. So this Ursa's still going to be able to get some fair amount of CS, but there's the charge out top lane. They're looking to bump into Infinity, the pullback right under the tower, and they follow with a nice stun. Can Greedy walk away from this one?
It's going to be close. Needs like one more great blocking there from Witchdoctor Salve as well.
Oh.
That was really well done by Unknown to save that. The charge was, if they would have gotten the cast bounce, if it would have like chain bounce, they would have gotten a kill there. But very good position from Jaw. He moved back away. The cast didn't bounce more than once, and they almost turned it. So good plays by both, I guess.
Very cheeky plays right here. Even Z-Talk just kind of creeping in from the woods. Maybe he's trying to linger in with one quick cask and trying to get the bump in. But help is already back. Jaws got his clarity building on up now. Looks like Bloody Nine back on stacking duty here. Gets another big stack onto that huge camp there for Justin.
It's the three, just the three stack. It's pretty good. Witch Doctor scouting things out. Just see what they got for medium camp. Bloody Nine's going to find him. Actually, he's in a lot of trouble. He's going to have another nuke in about 3 seconds. And
yeah,
that's it for him.
Easy solo pick there for your Skywrath Mage. And, well, they got to get the gist that there's some sort of stacking happening for that Skywrath Mage to be kind of just hanging out there. So I wonder if they'll do anything about it.
Well, he didn't see any stacks. He knows that there's stacks, probably, but doesn't know where they are. Stun comes through by Infinity. Almost gets killed. 15 HP. Ooh, he really wanted that one. That would have been a really big kill for Infinity there, but didn't quite have it. I'm glad he's getting Warcry points. We saw a game yesterday where a Chinese player got one Warcry up to level 22, and it made me really upset.
Midas. Midas is the pickup for Ursa.
On Ursa?
He's got it now, and he's going right to work with it. Just the second ever Midas. Okay. First pro Ursa.
Well, one really good thing about the Midas is that it allows him to just jungle AFK. And the attack speed's actually really good, because most Ursas never buy attack speed, right? So they rely almost entirely on overpower to get their attack speed. And it results in low farm over time. It, obviously, you get good burst against heroes and stuff. But
bottom lane, they're going for line right now. They got the new Cordy out. Arcane Rocket is going to be enough. They're going to clean it out. And Bloody Nine now on a killing spree, looking to make up for that Lina in the last game. They're off to a good start. Yeah.
Like, the couple kills is really big here. Might see a gank mid. There comes the charge. He's got an Invis rune, though. Do they have any detection? They actually don't. There's no way this will work, right?
Nope. Well, they will pop it. They got the vision for a little bit of time, but they have the dust. They do. Oh, man. Now Blade 9 back, trying to be that saving grace again. Gets the silence off.
MJW becomes great race.
Nice jump in. Also from your clockwork to help on out. Ends up being a one-for-one trade, but it's the Shadow Fiend down in exchange for the Witch Doctor.
They got a kill at least. I can't imagine they're too upset about that, considering what it could have been. Another stack comes through. And it will be not successful, actually. They're mispulling a little bit here. They could have an extra stack or two. Should be going north. Yeah.
That way, that's the better way?
The left barrier is somewhere around there, so it's pretty tough. Unless you go directly left. You either need to go directly left or directly up. It's the only way.
Yeah, we just draw. That's like the box area right there, but I know if support 101, usually by that point you want to be going much more up to the north.
So, I feel like their stacking could have been a little bit more efficient here. Small stacks like that are a big deal, especially with an SF. Like, he's going to kill at the same speed no matter how many stacks there are, so if you do end up missing stacks, it's a big loss. So a couple neutral camp or two, that's like half a level or 100 and some gold. Big deal.
Is it looking like this is going to be another game where he just needs to go right forward for that mech or maybe a stop off for the Yules along the way?
I think mech's really good idea when you're against an Ursa, since he does do mostly physical damage. So he's TPing the bot lane. Is he flying a smoke out? No, I think he's going back to farming. I think he's actually just AFK farming with the Midas.
That seems like something that he's done in his pubs that seemed to work out really well, and he's like, let's do it here. You know, kind of the same sense where EG pulled out the jungling Coddle in their matchup against Cloud9. Oh, top lane. They're making it go into Greedy. Stormhammer leads it on out. Plus, they got the Arcane Bolt. Z-Talk looking to help out with the cast, but doesn't quite stop him. They're still charging it. Nice raise snipe, and they might be able to follow up with another here. Infinity. One more second. He's got the secondary stun. Doesn't even need it. Gets the chop down kill. Oh, rotation in from Excel. Now he could be the one in trouble. They want this sweet, delicious kill to make it three all day.
Oh, great
nice
stun.
Nice stun.
The illusion.
Get the last
hit. It's faster.
Go.
If
he gets it. Oh, man.
That's a slight mistake from Bloody Nine to stand next to SF. That needed not happen. I really liked Infinity's play, though. That was really well done. He kind of overdived there, but it was enough to get the Lion to come back in. It should have been a Lion kill. That was just a good stun from Lion and mistake from Bloody Nine to not be separated from the Shadow Fiend. If either one of them didn't get stunned there, that was a dead Lion. But, you know, the cool thing about what Ursa's doing is that it keeps him off the map. The eHug doesn't know where he is, and then they have to do things like Rocket Roshan repeatedly to make sure that he's not there, or they have to worry about him jumping out with a blink and killing somebody. So, and it also gave Lion a lot of levels, or a lot of gold in his lane. He's got up to 1,000 gold. He's going to get ganked soon, though, and this is going to be a smoke. If they can hookshot him with the silence and the bonus magic damage, he should die, but he just shifted into the jungle. Infinity's here as well. He almost has his ultimate.
Oh, they're on the hunt, though.
I don't know if they can kill him with just these two. They're going to reveal. Here comes. Okay. Stun, silence, bonus damage here.
Oh,
they're not six yet. It's going to be close. He's going to start to overpower. Things are getting dangerous. Infinity taking a lot of damage. Rage comes off as well. Blocking damage. Hookshot's going to miss.
Oh!
Bloody Nine may be in trouble, but they should be able to grab the Ursa. He does end up falling. Infinity's got to run for his life, but he's got another stun. Buddy Nine, there's the finger of death. Earthspike as well. Buddy Nine should be fine, I think. And MJW running for his life, but Storm has quite a bit of mana. A couple more slows. Look at all the slows. That's a dead clockwork.
Oh, Buddy
and
Nine also.
Bad bounce there.
Oh, he's trying to clarity up for anything he can get, but they don't have enough to follow up with a new stun or any sort of nuke damage. So Blood Nine will be able to barely make it away, but when the dust settles, it does end up being a 2-for-1 trade on eHug, making that committed dive into the woods to take down the Ursa.
They really needed they needed three heroes to start that fight. If it was Clock with Sky and Sven, it would have been good. If Sky was 6, it would have been good, but their damage was just not bursty enough. They can't really rely on Sven auto-attacking like 4 times. It's just too dangerous versus an Ursa, so they maybe should have waited here at the entrance to the jungle till the creep wave pushed up, and then Clockwork could sneak in. Was the only way they could. They couldn't just run the Clockwork past, so it would have been maybe a little too obvious. So I just slightly poor planned gank there, I think.
Back we go. Really have yet to see the Storm Spirit go off the rails and try to maybe find some solo pickoffs himself. He is now level 9.
3-0-1. He's doing well, man.
I mean, the kills seem to kind of come to him almost, or he just has to kind of navigate a bit off from the mid lane to help out when needed. But it seems to be working for now. He's going to be going right for the Bloodstone, looking to accelerate that farm quite a bit. Certainly don't front him on that. And with that, looks like, okay, Greedy going to be Church busting his way through. Bot. Yeah. But they'll probably have to cancel it here.
They are not going to spot it with the rocket. Oh, he cancels. He could actually.
Did they see it with the rocket?
They did.
They did. That's a bad hero, man.
He's got sick. Oh, the cogs. No.
This is just the blunder is all over the place here from both sides. Now he's stuck on one side. MJW on the other here. He's going to bump him and charge him on one side.
Oh, he charged back again. MJW is still here. I don't know why he charged him. He's going to TP. I guess that's it.
He's going to make it out.
The short range. Look at this TP. Look at that value. It's like a blink dagger for 100 gold. He really shouldn't have cogged there. It's a little too dangerous. It sometimes pushes people away. There's no reason to cog there at all.
Oh, Blade Nine's going to catch out the charge. They're going to make the jump. There's the ball lightning on forward. Oh, can they get it quite yet? Justin looking to go for the race. Good. Not going to get it there, though. And the silence on Storm Spirit's going to help finish him off. Can they catch him before he TP's out? They can't.
Oh, my gosh.
They
so
can't.
So close. Well, that's the problem with Shadow Fiend when you're against him, at least. If he survives, you die. And a lot of deaths, usually. So big silence there on the Storm. And even Sky going for a very Arcane Bolt-heavy build. He favors the triple Null Talisman. It gives you really good early game in terms of your damage.
Yeah.
Your nukes go farther, but the silence duration is a bit weak. As Witch Doctor is going for this one.
Ooh, nice little casual bump. Look at that. It's going to fly right through the eHug squad.
But Cask is going to end by the time Spiritbreaker gets here. Oh,
no
wait,
one's there. But they're hungry. They want that tower. They don't want to give it away for free here. And they already used the glyph.
Ooh,
big damage onto Z-Talk, but it will help secure eHug the tower.
Infinity playing very rotate heavy. He's not really playing a hard carry role. They're playing like a mid Shadow Fiend carry role. Is kind of how it seems eHug playstyles this.
Mm-hmm.
So Infinity does the rotations with the supports. He played Bristleback in the last game.
Yeah.
And he goes to set up kills. And right there, he was like, I'm not going to go for the tower. I'm going to pressure the supports, make sure that they can't deny this. And by doing that, he gets his team more gold. So it kind of, their playstyle might lead to more of a one-core playstyle, but because Skywrath is doing so well this game, I think they're completely fine doing this. He's Bloody Nine playing really well this game, 5-0-3, so definitely justifying the Skywrath pick. This is kind of what you need to do to make Skywrath good.
And with that, well, it's no surprise he's looking to push on forward into what looks like a Blink Dagger. Could certainly help. Infinity looking to trade it about. Unknown, though, looking to surround this top lane. It's a lone Infinity, at least for now. I believe I'm still alive. I'm just going to keep going. Oh, okay. I mean, I'm still connected to the game as if I have internet. All right. Oh.
Okay.
All right. No problem. No problem.
I don't know if my computer's on. Oh, there we go. So we saw.
Yeah, I'm not up anymore.
Okay.
No problem. Just let us know when you got everything back up. We're back in, folks. Sorry about the temporary outage right there. Unfortunately, you didn't miss a whole lot. Unknown did take one fight at the top lane. They lost, I believe, three, it looked like. And eHug are still in strong shape now, pulling ahead 12-5.
Yeah, Bloody Nine playing really well. Hasn't died quite yet here. Looks like we're going to see Sven die. I do not have in-game audio, by the way.
I don't either.
Only thing I am missing right now.
Well, they get the bump there on the top lane. Sven is going to go down here, so a successful gank right there. Really the first time it seems that the Ursa really participating in something, and that certainly helps having that blink dagger on his side. So with that, you know, they'll be able to get the grab right there. Not looking to go for the Roche quite yet, maybe looking to get something of their own. Meanwhile, mid lane, eHug making their own push attempt, going past that tier 1. But quickly Unknown pull all hands on deck to help thwart them, and it looks like they're going to head their way out. But there's the charge. It's charging on through. It's going to connect onto Justin here. He's going to get bumped back. They get their own charge onto him. Hits the 2. Ooh! Fortunately, that Bloody Nine drop down from the Mystic Flare. Not going to be off the mark, but look at the cask. Look at the Death Ward. Look at the damage! Z-Talk puts in his work. It's going to help out and taking down that first Aegis life, and MJW going to get slashed apart right now with Mr. Kataro moving on in. Requiem on the Birth, and unfortunately, it's not going to be a whole lot of damage. Tries to go for the snipe onto Mr. Kanoa, but he's going to walk away, and everyone says, we got to go. Unknown are able to leave this fight with a 4-for-1 trade.
Just a little bit too greedy a play there by eHug. The Rubick went for the charge rather than going for the lift, and he ended up getting stunned on the way through, which meant his hero really didn't do a whole lot. So that was the unstoppable streak going away for Skyrath Mage. He ended up buying a dag on this game. I actually like this purchase because he did have so many null talismans and naturally builds into it. Mm-hmm. And against a storm, especially if you have something like Ancient Seal, it's leveraging your damage a lot higher. So they have pretty decent nuke heroes. It's a good way to try to burst him down in the small amount of time that you do have to kill him if you are stun weak. So
Rubick Seals Maldict. You put the dagon on that? Hell yeah.
Yeah, that'd be pretty cool. I'm into that. Another charge going top.
Okay.
It's going to cancel though.
Yeah.
Infinity having a bit of a tough game. His net worth is not very high, but he did go for a drum build. His biggest threat is definitely going to be the Ursa here, but as they do get more and more Warcry levels, he'll be a little safer.
Yeah, I do fear for the way that they're going to be able to dish out all the raw damage from a Sven. I don't know what they really have to lock down aside from a telekinesis maybe in his own little stun to keep him in place, and if they go into a man fight, Ursa's certainly going to get the better deal. And it looks like Ursa is going to be going for a BKB here, the Mithril Hammer grab.
Could be a Desolator as well, because Furious Oaks is no longer an orb, and it's all this physical damage. So if you subtract 7 armor on top of that, then you're hitting even harder. So definitely a possibility. Blink Dagger's long done online here. Almost got his Tranquil Boots as well, and maybe another fight developing mid. But there's a BKB, a DD, and a mech on Shadowfiend. Justin, again, having some huge net worth. Hookshot comes in on the Storm Spirit, but he's going to cog him back. Looking for the sounds. Great initiation from MJW. They're going to try to pick off Storm, but they're not going to be able to. Bloody Nine trying to overextend, but gets the dagger on before he dies, and his ultimate as well, but that might not be enough. A slow on Spirit Breaker as well, and they're just going to get a line for this. Not quite what they wanted there. That was very close. Good initiation.
Yeah.
Good execution, but it just caused them to charge right into the enemy team, and they're going in. Rubick's in trouble, gets lifted. He had a great spell too. Great rate and rage as well to stop the damage output for a second. MJW running for his life, but the big hits on Ursa. Now Ursa's got to be really careful, but no slows, no hookshot for 20, and he's going to be able to get away.
Yep. Oh, man. This all started from a very nice setup from eHug here. Ooh, TP. He will make it out just fine. But yeah, nice jump in coming out. MJW is able to bump him back into the silence, but unfortunately, they just couldn't get themselves on top of the hill. Maybe a bit of a lack of vision, being nighttime and all. They couldn't push on forward. Plus, you had Greedy, the Spear Breaker, right there to kind of act as that line breaker. Pushes them on back, and then it gets a bit hectic right there. Ursa is able to jump past those front lines and gets his own bit of a kill. So, not really coming too easy there for eHug, even after that nice start.
Really rough that Rubick ended up dying there. He had Impale as a spell, and that easily allows him to deal with the Storm Spirit because that gives him almost 5 seconds of disable, plus extra nuke. So really unfortunate for him that the Ursa picked him up. There's the ball all the way in the mid lane. Bloody Nine gets killed very, very easily. Definitely overly aggressive here. I feel like Bloody Nine is more of a core player. He's kind of playing his supports like a core. Like, if we looked at what happened last game, he got behind, and it seemed like he didn't really know what to do because he couldn't just farm a lane. This game, he got really far ahead and is doing really well at that, but now he's doing things that are maybe a little bit too overly aggressive, crossing the river by himself to try to get a solo kill on a support. Like, yeah, he maybe could have, but if any other hero was there, he just dies. Blink Dagger on Infinity, throws the stun, and gets dodged very, very easily, and they will deny the mid tower.
Blade 9 is their most recent addition, and normally he's notable for playing a lot of offlane, but eHug already have Mikey J. White, who's been their offlaner for the longest time, and a good offlaner at that, but you know, you could be right. It's very uncharacteristic for him. Strong start, but you got to remember you're a Skywrath mage after all. You're very freaking frail.
Especially against versus a Storm and an Ursa. Like, especially the Ursa. If Ursa jumps on you, you die no matter what.
Yeah, 9-10 life, you know, a quick level 2 finger, and you're in trouble.
Yep. So it is actually going to be a BKB on Ursa. You're right about that one. There's not a ton of disables on eHug, but there's enough where it gets a little scary if you do get locked down. Smoke coming from eHug, 4-man here, and Bloody Nine going to be the one that was not smoked. He may get spotted in this war. He does not, but...
He's been demoted.
A little surprising. I think this is maybe not the best use of a smoke here. They'll probably kill the Spirit Breaker, very likely.
Yeah.
But they didn't really need to do that. He was farming pretty far out. He could have just walked through. Hookshot another hero, grabbing the Wish Doctor. All right, things are worth it.
Hey, here comes your jaw charge. You're going to bump in for the KS. Nicely done there, Rubik. So they make it a twofer. Not
that's
too shabby. Good grab, good lead in, good eyes, and of course, good hook shot there coming out from Mikey G. White.
I think I would have liked to see him steal Cask, though. Blinking towards the Storm. Again, they're going for it. Oh, he's going to be able to get away, though. John, that's not safe.
Yeah.
Run away. It's a 2-second stun if they can connect it, but I think the Cask would have been a bit safer, even against the Storm.
Well, here comes eHug. They're looking for this Tier 2 to finish it off. Already pretty dang low. They get it relatively easy. It's going to go for Justin as well. So he's got about 2.5k.
I guess they're going to keep going. They just rocketed. Roshan is not there, so they keep pushing.
They're trying to split push. Unknown's working down the mid and top lane, but it's not stopping eHug quite yet. And actually, as I say that, looks like they are going to be making the call to pull back.
They have no mana. Shadow Fiend only has 60. He has a 15 charge. He has to mech, and he has to ulti, and possibly raise multiple times. There's no way that they can continue this. So they back off. They grab a Sanj. You know what? I think I dare say this is a better Sanj and Yasha game than Scotty game.
Why do you dare say that?
It's kind of a similar item, right? The item is very similar, except the main difference is that Scotty's more stats and Sanj and Yasha's big movement speed. The charge comes through. It's going to be on Shadow Fiend. He's got a BKB and a DD, though. I don't think... well, if Justin dies right here, this is pretty bad. But there it is, BKB, DD. Look at the damage he's taking. He's just getting blown up with the Enrage. He's doing so much.
What a man.
He ends up getting him. Sky comes in, but... Oh, there's a lift on top of the stun, but no sounds for 3 seconds. They almost get him. Yule's goes in the air. Can they have the neutral silence?
No, he's jumping behind. He's going to try to cut him.
Oh, my gosh. What a fight. 3 dead heroes on eHug, 2 on Unknown, and it looks like Infinity will live. Man, that Ursa, I was like, all right, he's dead, right? And then all of a sudden, Fury's Enrage lasted for 4 seconds, and he just would not die.
Press R, you're immortal, apparently.
Yeah.
It's crazy. What is it, 90%? Is that what it is? 80%.
They nerfed it. No, I thought they nerfed it. Didn't they reduce it by 10%?
Yeah, I think it was 90, and now it's 80. But, I mean, 80% still seems like a hell of a lot to be able to shrug all that off and be like, I'm not done yet.
I thought they went lower than that.
Shoves everyone out of the way.
That was impressive. SF was like, all right, you're dead. Like, I got you. I just got you down to 20%. You went all in on me, and it didn't work out. That was a big mistake. I dare say the supports as well were holding their stuns because they're like, this guy's done. We don't want to waste this. But instead, SF goes from having, like, 1,800 HP to having nothing and being dead. And they maybe should have gone a little bit more stun-heavy on the Ursa, possibly, I think is what we saw out of that. I feel like Sky misused his silence as well, because when the storm finally went on him, his silence was long on cooldown. I think he maybe used it on Ursa. But possibly too late. I feel like slightly better supports efficiency there would have led to a huge eHug victory. So slightly weak team fight from them. That could have been better.
Props to maybe Kataro, possibly a big Ursa player, knows the limits of the hero.
Yeah,
to know how much he can man up. I mean, yeah, you got to go out without a fight, but he was just like, he had his eyes locked and he wanted to finish what he had started.
Yeah. On all the heroes he's playing, he's just forcing really hard. And it's pretty safe forces. It forces opponents to do... maybe things they're not expecting to, that makes them do things that they're not comfortable with, and he's forcing mistakes, essentially, by doing this. So, but yeah, I think the SNY is pretty good here. It's kind of like a Scotty, but he also needs some movement speed to get away from the Ursa in the first place. So, rather than being an all-slow item, it's like a half-slow, half-movement speed, and I think it's a good choice here.
Yeah.
It's a little item expensive, item slot expensive, but I think that's all right in this case.
And also, you know, the Lion looking to finish out a 4-staff. Definitely needed someone to get a 4-staff on their team for this clockwork on the other side. But here we go. It's eHug now looking to move into the pit. Doesn't look like Unknown, who do smoke up. And, oh, they got the Storm. He's already planting down that little site on the high ground here. Grand Theft Aegis There's a bit of a scare here for eHug as they pull back, and uh-oh, BKB. They're going to make it out alive. He's charging on in with BKB out. Infinity going to be locked down and dropped. Now the ward from Z-Talk on the low ground going to be dishing huge damage. MJW going to get dropped. Three down all day. About to make it four with Ja as they charge on in. Trying to finish off this Rubick. He's got to go. Bloody Nine, the only survivor who was not really there to help out. It's just devastation for eHug as Unknown take the cake and looking to take the Roche 19-19.
That's a really high win rate, and it makes sense. It's kind of like having Wisp plus more mobile heroes. If all of your heroes are extremely mobile, your opponents are very limited by your range of mobility with their low mobility, and that's what they have. They start running away, and they've got some blink daggers, but they have a couple slow guys as well. Okay, he TP's home. He's going to be just fine. But that BKB on Ursa is so big. Again, does really aggressive things, jumps in, enrages BKBs, and all eHug can basically do is walk away. Maybe they should have burned the hookshot or something like that because Ursa blew up Sven so fast, but they just took so much damage. And I think Storm did like a full range roll on that as well. They planned that out very well. But maybe eHug needed to get kills before they took the Roche. It was a little greedy to chance that based on how well they initiate the team fight.
So tier 2 will go down, and if you're looking to try to run away from an Ursa when he does get that kind of a jump in, it's not going to be easy soon. He's already got a basher complete. It's en route right now, and with that he'll have that extra bit of lockdown when the abyssal comes. It's certainly going to be devastating for eHug and something they're going to have to watch out for. So Unknown put themselves back in a pretty strong position. Looking at the early net worth graph, Unknown, well, they are commanding right now about a 6 to 7K net worth advantage, so they're in pretty good standing.
That's really good for them. Wow, look at that. So it's just vertical. Whew.
Boom. XP right there with it. Even more devastating.
So that was a great death ward by Witch Doctor in the last fight as well, but I don't know if there's a whole lot they could have done, though, in that fight. This charge is coming on Shadow Fiend, but Ehug's sitting behind. Skywrath Mage is going to get spotted. So they probably will cancel the charge. Another TP, and they're like, oh, there's four heroes there.
He's going for bloody.
We get four kills then instead of just one.
Oh,
Soundslands.
Oh, hookshot. He's waiting for it.
He heals himself. They might turn things around. Stun comes in, lands on Storm Spirit. He might be in trouble. Can they live? They do. Great. Sky ulti as well, and that's a dead Storm. Aegis is down. He'll be respawning shortly with full mana pool. There's a stun from Line, maybe a Finger of Death as well. Storm Spirit gets silenced again. Yule's up in the air. That'll remove it. Justin pops BKB, though. He doesn't have mana for his ulti. He really wants to ulti here, but he just can't. Stun comes through.
Oh, no!
Storm again. Infinity in trouble. Ursa picks him up. BKB enrages down. Great stun on two heroes, but the Clockwork Battery Assault going to finish offline most likely, except for Glimmer Cape. Makes him invisible, running away, getting healed up by Witch Doctor as well. The chase is not done. The bash plant on the TP, and Justin, he just needed 150 mana there, and he could have completely changed that team fight. Instead, Unknown roll over eHug in another fight.
They were just so slippery, man. Lion able to get themselves to the low ground with that four staff, and then there at the end with the Glimmer Cape, just nothing coming easy to eHug, and they were able to prolong that fight enough for Ursa to make that trip from the mid lane all the way up there, and when he showed up, he was just so happy to be able to clean up all of the leftovers, and he takes down two, helps with that third as well, and now Unknown looking to push ahead and advance that net worth lead even further, and they're going to follow it up with a tier 2, I'd imagine, right here at the top lane.
The only thing eHug did really well in that fight, though, was taking out Storm. They did a great job killing Storm Spirit, but because it was just an Aegis, and all of a sudden Ursa shows up, they just don't quite have enough disables to deal with the fact that they're behind. They needed a big gold advantage, I think, or they needed Jaw to always have a second stun on hand. I mean, if they had maybe a Lion or something like that instead of a Rubick, I feel like they would have been an okay place here, but Unknown bought, they drafted so many greedy heroes, or so many diving heroes. They got Spearbreaker, they got Ursa, and they got Storm. Oh. All three of those you got to deal with.
They're going to get Z-Talk, it looks like, here. He does get the self Glimmer Cape off, but they got him locked in place. Now he's able to be forced out with some assistance, but yeah, he's got nowhere to really go. They should be able to chop him down. It looks like the Voodoo Restoration will be stolen there from Jaw at the end. The game plan seemed to be from Unknown to make their way back to the bottom lane, push that out, and go all the way up to that tier 2, but they were lingering about maybe, you know, putting down some of these aggressive wards, giving them a little bit of that vision to see who's kind of rotating around from the eHug side in and out of the jungle. But with that, they will lose their little Witch Doctor.
So eHug just kind of getting overran. The enemy team runs at him. Maybe they need Clockwork to go in first. A lot of the times, we haven't really been seeing it Clockwork initiated. I feel like it's always Unknown going in first. Maybe if you can have Clockwork go in first, disable Blink Daggers for Ursa, at least it delays him being able to initiate. Get some cogs down to stop the Spirit Breaker as well. I feel like there's ways that they could counteract what Unknown is doing for initiations, but their wards are maybe not the best. I feel like these are very defensive wards. They're not really spotty in movement of Unknown very much. I mean, the bot one is obviously for Roshan, but the top one protects their jungles. I feel like their warding is maybe not in the best spots. Like, if you compare it to what Unknown's got, look at their places. They're spotting where eHug is. They can see where their heroes are. They can initiate in farm heroes farming in the jungle, whereas these places are not places where people are standing a lot of time. You're not going to like see them standing around and get to initiate in the river. Nobody stands there, you know? So it's going to spot some rotations and give them some Rosh advantage, but in terms of like starting a team fight, the wards aren't very good for that.
Well, they are able to scrape together a gem, it looks like, for eHug here. Bullet 9 might be picking it up. He's the one that did purchase it here, but Scraper they'll need to be able to get it out. But yeah, they're moving in. Infinity, though, gets himself back into the baseline. But eHug, if they want to be able to reclaim some of this jungle to farm and some of this lane aggression, they're going to need to get that gem out there and deward this bit of aggression. But already, here comes Team Unknown from the south side looking to knock on this tier 2. And okay, they could get a quick and easy pick here. It looks like they will. Good quick grab. Good spot.
That was the gem pickup. That helped a lot, actually. It grabs a line behind the tower. They should be able to get this observer ward in a second once they retain control of outside. But they've got to be a little careful. Almost a stun. BKB gets used and needs to Warcry. Gets a Warcry off, but he's still taking so much damage. Four step. Stormspear comes through. Shiva's on everybody. Oof. And the AoE damage is just coming out. And again, eHug running for their life. Still no hookshot from MJW.
Triple kill for Kataro already. Make it possibly an ultra here if he's able to slash down Jaw. No, but still a slaughter nonetheless, making a five-man wipe, and there's the ultra from Kataro, the Beast Man, able to just clear out. No mercy. He just jumped on Sven and made him look like a little scared baby.
In the past, like pre-enraged change, I feel like Ursa would have been good there, but not amazing. But with the new enraged change, that was amazing. That was through Warcry. He had 20 extra armor during that, and he still got blown up. Obviously, his net worth is much less than what Ursa is dealing with, but that was impressive. And again, same situation happens. Unknown runs over eHug. They don't counter-initiate. I feel like we really need to see MJW initiate to at least stop the charge coming or something. I don't know. But they can't stop Stormspear from going in, that's for sure. He just Shivas and balls in. Everybody's slowed and flustered and like, what the hell do I do at this point? It's really tough. They can't even rely on silencing the storm and bursting him down anymore because he has the Yules. So once he becomes survivable against the picks that eHug has, their other carries to just keep running. Can't get stopped. Hookshot goes in. They're going to grab Storm Spirit, gets thrown in the air. There's a stun on him, lift and follow up, and almost a kill, but Dusk gets used, but Glimmer Cave keeps him alive. He's going to be able to live now. Infinity in trouble. Ursa's going after him. He does have Enrage in just a moment, but MJW gets blown up in four hits with one Bastion. Look at the damage. Hitting for 465. That's got to be good game, surely. And there it is. eHug getting 2-0'd again for their second set here. Rough games for them and nicely played by Unknown. They just really good picks. They played really aggressive. They forced errors from their opponents. And even when they were behind sometimes, they just continued to take fights and get slightly more advantageous trades than eHug did.
Just aggressive, man. Really aggressive. Felt like, yeah, even if like they were being taken advantage of, the start of this game looked very good for eHug, but that didn't seem to faze them at all. They're just like, nope, we're not stopping. We're going ruthless here.
Yeah.
Their Ursa pick seems a bit questionable. Then he leads into a Midas, and this is something we've never seen, but he's persistent. He goes through his farm, and then he gets his Blink Dagger, and then it's no holds barred. He goes crazy.
It was a nice way to do it, basically, because by getting the Midas, he guaranteed his late game farm. If his ganks went a little bad, his farm speed is definitely lower than a Sven's or even a Storm Spirit, for example. Mm-hmm. So by grabbing the early Midas, he gave his Lion space to farm. His Blink Dagger came out late. He played it very different than how you see Ursas in pubs. In pubs, you're like, get level 4, steal Roshan, win game. But if you fail the steal, then Ursa ends up being terrible because then you don't have a Blink and it's all delayed and stuff. So he went for Midas. He just transitioned into a later Blink and then started doing some really aggressive moves that scored a lot of kills. It was a lot of good cooldown management of his opponents by him, basically. Mm-hmm. Jumping on the important heroes, getting the pickoffs on the supports that he needed, and transitioning really well. So there's the stats for the game.
Yeah.
Really well played
13,
by
13-3-10.
He played fantastic. I think Storm did really well this game as well.
Yeah,
definitely. Who would you say the MVP is?
I mean, without question, it's got to be this handsome man right here, Mr. MNZ, also known as the Kataro one, the beastly guy. My goodness,
it was definitely very well played by him. I think I would say you definitely played better than Storm Spirit. I think not dying on Storm Spirits maybe a little easier than on Ursa, but he...
I mean, I wouldn't say the game was all him. Certainly got to give credit to the rest of his team for helping it out, but it's very apparent he was the standout. He was the standout that game, though.
Yeah, I agree with that. Mm-hmm. Transitioned items really well. Very efficient for his items. Good jungling farming. He was like a level 4, and he was like into the jungle. He didn't care about his max efficiency. He was like, I want to give Lion some levels, give Lion some gold. Lion transitioned really well. They just team fought really... really great, and had a lot of good team movements as well. So,
yeah,
pretty good win for them. That gives them 3 points.
Yeah,
that's big. There's not a lot of team getting 3 points
no,
per match.
No, I'm actually really excited to see how they match up against some of the teams that are expected to come on top. I'm already ready to see Team Unknown take on Mouseports, just to like really gauge where it is. You know, this Peruvian squad, they're probably coming into this playing with a little bit of a ping. They already had to battle their way through a very exhausting open qualifier, but doesn't seem to faze them. They come out strong in their first series, man. So we're going to be looking forward to that, but that's going to wrap up this best of two series, and we're going to go to a small break. When we come back, our next matchup here, as I flip through my fancy book here, looks like it will be Leviathan taking on the Void Boys Purge. So we'll take a little bit of a break here, but when we return, Leviathan versus Void Boys. See you soon.